If I fall asleep tonight, I'll designate you to come up wake me up. After 20 hours of travel yesterday, you expect jet lag. But then, is Darren Parker blindsided me last night. He knows I got my knees buckled when somebody offers fishing, so they're taking me out Sunday morning. But then he says, Wayne Calhoun will take you out this morning if you want to go. And so I asked, what time? 3:30 in the morning. So I'm up at, I set the alarm at 3:15. I thought, okay, that'll give me enough time. But I woke up at 3 o'clock in anticipation of going fishing. Well, we spent 12 hours out in the water today. We had an incredible time with Peter Arnold came along as well. And we're pounding our way out there. But, it was an incredibly calm day out there. Usually when you get the outside, what's the name of your island again? It starts with an M. Morton. Yeah, we went to Morton Island. We fished all on the inside. Then we went on all the outside, and it was just like glass calm out there. And we had whales coming by us and breaching within 30 meters of us, and we had dolphins all over the place and sea turtles. It was a totally unbelievable day. And I've been on your water a lot. That's the first time I've ever seen it like that. It was a God-given day. But then, of course, I haven't had sleep for a long time, too. So, so I'll probably be catching up right about now. Anyhow, no, it was great being here again. I'd said no. My wife is trying to teach me to say no more often. And so when your President George phoned me, I said no about 5 times because it kept going, emails and emails. I said no, and my wife was proud of me. Then they put on, then it was Murray Hunter, Muzz. They put Muzz on me. And so that's a little tougher. And so, and of course he's using all his sarcastic humor on me, like what a loser I am and all that kind of stuff, That's always good motivation. And so started a whole bunch of emails. I finally got him out of the way. So I'd said no about 10 times already. And then, so I thought, done. And I told my wife, aren't you proud of me? I'm really proud of you. Then they put Andy Litchfield on me. And Andy and I were in a band together in Walla Walla when we went to university for 4 years. Andy, brother, and himself and my in a bluegrass band. So he starts, he says, Herb, you got to do it for me. And he says, for old time's sake. And I said, come on, that's not fair. He says, you got to help me out. Well, guess what? He isn't in charge here. I didn't find that out last night. I come here, I says, where's Andy? Oh, he has nothing to do with this meeting. So I run into him out here afterwards, after I'm done meeting the team here, and I feel like I was really blindsided. So I said, hey, you said, help me out. And you said you're going to be here working on this. He says, no, I didn't say that. I said, well, what do you mean by you got to help me out here? And he says, well, no, I just, come help us out. I says, no, you said help me out, whatever. You got a great team. I'm enjoying working with the team. But anyways, so in his coercion, I finally said yes. So I went back to my wife, my tail between my legs, and says, honey, it was Andy. I'm sorry. I couldn't say no. Anyways, so I am happy to be here. It's just that I've been traveling a lot lately, and I looked at my schedule when I did this. I was in Australia 2 months ago, I think it was, Townsville. Were some of you in Townsville? Was that 2 months ago? When was that? June? Oh, okay, 3 months, whatever. Time flies. Not necessarily when you're having fun, but time flies. And so then I was in Cambodia and Singapore last month. And so, I looked at my schedule and I thought, oh man, this is going to be a tough one. And now I'm here again. But you know what? I do enjoy it once I get here and I get over the jet lag and I get back to with friends. Russell came up from Sydney here and of course, hanging out with the guys on the boat today and everything else. And there might be some more boat trips coming up here, so I may not get over jet lag this whole time. But anyways, great to be back here again. I had such a great time when I was here in 2006. It was an incredible time working with Murray Hunter and Andy Litchfield and all of them back then. And now we've got a new team to work with. It's been great. I so enjoyed myself back then that, now that I'm here, the juices are getting flowing. And thanks, praise group. If I can get up and I can sing hard, it kind of rejuvenates you a little bit, and to vent a little praise. I met a sister here tonight. She said she gave her heart to Jesus. Somebody came and invited her in 2006 to come to the meetings when I was here in the youth. Are you a youth? I think you're a youth, right? No. Anyway, she said after the meeting, she gave her heart to Jesus. She's here tonight. Praise God for that. So anyways, you know, the praise music, thanks again. It got the juices flowing a little bit because I was slumping a little bit. Thank you. And it's good. You know, the drums, my son plays the drums. And he buys and sells vintage drums. He buys these old things from the 60s and the 70s, and he refurbishes the whole thing. So he's gone through at least six sets of drums because he's been home for the summer. He graduated with his doctorate degree in physical therapy, and it's taking a little bit of a break before he gets into the workforce. So he's been at home for the last couple of months. And of course, he's passionate about these drums. So he went through six sets of drums in our living room. Rebuilding, and my wife was just having a conniption fit. You know, she sees sheets put out on the floor, and there's drum parts everywhere, and he's got polishing compound, everything, and he wanted to be with the family, right? So anyways, he went through six sets of drums this summer, and now he's building another brand new set right now. So I was on the phone with him last night, and he's telling me, oh, yeah, Dad, this one's really cool, and it's all mahogany and whatever else and whatever. You know, I'm trying to understand it, but, you know. So around home, we've always had drums, and we've always had music. The kids have always been into music. We have a music room at home. And then the guitars and all these instruments and stuff. So to hear lively music again, hey, it takes me home. So thanks, guys. Okay, before we begin, we'll start with a word of prayer because I have to get done a little quicker tonight than sometimes. You know, my dad's always told me, he's a pastor. He said, son, it's easy to take off. It's harder to land. And so, because sometimes it is hardly shut down. But we've got little kids that are coming back in here. So that's my motivation. Bow our heads. Father God, we come before you tonight wanting to glorify your name. We want to declare before the universe that you are the King of Kings, the Lord of Lords, creator of the universe. And we know that because we are sinful beings and we've seen both sides of this story. So, Father, we want to thank you and give you glory tonight for the fact that you are a God of love, compassion. You loved us so much that instead of just being specks of dust on this earth, you've adopted us and made us your children. I want to thank you for that, Father God. Jesus, I want to again address you tonight. We don't even know how to begin to comprehend what you went through on Calvary, but Jesus, we accept the sacrifice you made for us on Calvary. We accept the fact that you took each one of our sins completely and paid the price so that we can move from death row into eternal life. And we want to thank you for that, Jesus. Instead of saying thank you, we just want to turn our lives over to you completely. Satan, I want to address you tonight. I know you're going to want to be here, especially tonight, because I'm going to be talking about you tonight. But I command you now in the name of Jesus and by the power and the blood that he spilled on Calvary that you leave this place. You have no right to be here, you and your evil forces. You have no right to inhabit anybody. You have no right to even come near this place because we declare before the universe this to be a closed meeting between ourselves and our Father God. Now, Holy Spirit, in that void, I'm asking that you'd come to this place right now. Settle down inside each one of us. And I pray that it'll be like sweet incense for us. And Holy Spirit, I give you these lips to speak what you want to speak about. I present this petition now in the name of Jesus. Amen. What I want to talk about tonight, and I didn't really know what I was going to talk about till this morning when I woke up at 3 o'clock, but it just felt on my heart that, because I've been asked to speak about this more often lately. Recently, I think it was last year, I was asked to speak at one of our colleges in Canada first. And I said, do you have any idea what we need to talk about? And they says, yeah, we want you to talk about the spiritualism and the occult and what's going on and what's the devil up to. And I'm thinking, whoa, okay, that's a pretty bizarre topic to be asking me to speak about. So I went and did that. Well, then I was supposed to go speak at Walla Walla College next, Walla Walla University. And I said, what do you want me to speak about? And they asked me to speak about the same thing, not knowing that that's what I spoke about. So I'm thinking, okay, what is it about this? But, you know, it is important to understand the devil's up to something. The devil's alive and well. And I don't want to glorify him in any way tonight. But until we understand what Satan is up to and how he wants to destroy us and how he wants to take us down, we can hardly appreciate, or not hardly, but we can appreciate Jesus much more if we understand what the devil's up to. Because I want to tell you something. I've had lots of encounters with the devil in my life, and he never quits. There's possession, there's oppression, there's harassment. I get harassed all the time. I get oppressed sometimes by the devil. And the thing is he is real, he's alive, and he's well. And the Bible's given us a fair amount of information about him. First of all, going back to the great controversy, we know what happened. In heaven, he was a favorite angel. And pride got into his life, and he decided, I want to be like the Most High. In fact, I want to be above the Most High. We all understand what took place there. But he's able to deceive one-third of angels, and I thought, how? I spent hours and hours trying to contemplate, how in the world would you deceive one-third of contented angels, angels that are living in utopia? And I never could understand that until one day I was studying, how did he deceive us? I know how he fell, it was through pride. I know how he got us to fall, it was through pride. He said, you shall be like gods. In other words, don't be content with your life right now. Strive for something greater than we already have. And so that's what Adam and Eve did. And then I thought, okay, he wanted something more, he wanted to be like God. He promised Adam and Eve, you will be as gods. How would he take down a third of the angels? And all of a sudden it became clear to me. As the lead angel, it'd be fairly easy for him to be going around complimenting the angels and say, you're incredible, you're wonderful. And then before long, when they begin to look away from God and they look to themselves, self, now what does he say? You can be like gods. I've discovered what we can do. And one-third fell for that. But because one-third fell for that, we now have that one-third of angels inhabiting this planet. And they're not going to be content sitting around, because the Bible says in the last days, the devil will go around like a roaring lion. Now, I'd rather twist those words around in the reality of it. It's like the lion that roars. Because if any of you have ever watched a cat take down its prey, how does it do that? Does it announce itself? No, absolutely not. I've watched many cats take down birds, and I've watched the Planet Earth or whatever that program's called, where in DVDs where you see a lion or a jaguar, what are these different cats, when they take down their prey. I mean, it's so subtle, the prey never has a clue what's coming. That's the way Satan works in the last days. That's the way he works all the time. It's a subtlety, and he's after you and me. And you know, it's a topic that I'm not here to shock you with, but I think it's important to understand what the devil's up to and how he works in and around our lives all the time, trying to bring us down. Because the Bible is full of examples of people that were harassed, if not, or possessed with the devil. Jesus, when he was walking this earth, there was demon possession all over the place, and the disciples, as well as Jesus, were casting demons out. Afterwards, after Jesus goes back to heaven, he gives a commission to the disciples. Heal the sick and cast demons out of people. And if you look at all these bunch of these examples, you find that a lot of the healings in the New Testament are by way of casting demons out. And here's what I found interesting. As we see all this stuff taking place in the early church, and we see it taking place in the Gospels, in the New Testament, but we don't see it taking place today. Why is that? Oh, yeah, we hear mission stories about, oh, yeah, they had an encounter with the devil over there in some foreign land. And yet we never acknowledge that it really takes place here. Is it? Or is Satan quieter now? Is he kind of given up on his things? No, you know what? He's alive and well. When I was a teenager, some of you may have heard this story. When I was a teenager, of course, I'm a preacher's kid. We're down in the basement of our church one time because our parents were upstairs having a meeting. This is Sabbath afternoon. And we're in the basement of our church, a bunch of us youth. Half of them are preacher's kids. And someone knew, a visitor came, and he said, hey, you want to do something fun? We said, what? Well, I'll teach you how to hypnotize. Yeah, we didn't like the sounds of that. But you know what? Let him fool around with it. This one girl says she will be allowing this guy to hypnotize her. So he hypnotizes her. So we're all watching this. And then he takes her head and puts it on a chair and her heels on another chair. And she's straight as a board. And at that time, I'm like 16 years old. I don't know much about physiology, but this much I knew. I was a tough hockey player. I couldn't do that. Be stiff as a board, head on one chair and heels on another chair. Then the guy says, bunch of you sit on her. We sat on her and she didn't bend. And I thought, this seems a little bit beyond mind over matter. But it never ended there, because the guy taught the rest of all of us how to hypnotize. I didn't want to be involved with it. And I thank God. God was behind the scenes at that time in my life, even though I was in a rebellious state. And so all my friends began to get into this and playing around with this hypnotism stuff, and they started doing it at our academy in school. So when the teachers were out, this is what they would do. And it got wilder and wilder and wilder. First, it was funny. Hey, you know, you're a dog and you got to go to the bathroom and that's a fire hydrant over there. What do you think the person did? Well, that was funny in class, you know, and teachers are out of the classroom, whatever else. And so, you know, yeah, this is funny. But it got worse and worse. And I remember one night, we all lied to our parents that we're going over to another pastor's home and said they're home. They weren't. The parents were gone out of town. We all went over there and had a party. What do you think the entertainment was? It was hypnotism. And so everybody's hypnotizing each other, and everybody's trying to outdo the other person. And I remember I went to the party with this one girl. She's quite frail, small, considered, you know, considerably smaller than me for sure. And they hypnotize her and tell her she's a she-beast, and she can't move fast at all until she gets within 5 feet of me, and then she becomes hyper. And I'm sitting in the kitchen. I don't even know this is going on. She comes out of the side room, and she starts walking to me, hissing, and her face is contorted, and she's got her fingernails out like this and all that, and she's just barely walking in slow motion. All of a sudden, she gets right in front of me, and she just turns absolutely hyperactive and attacks me. And I can hardly put her off. And so finally, I slam her on the floor. I'm not that I'm a bad guy or anything, but I couldn't deal with it. So I slam her on the phone. I couldn't pin her down. And I'm screaming at the other person to take her out of this because I'm having a tough time handling her. So they get her out of it. Gets worse. 20 minutes later, so one of my best friends, a girl hypnotizes him, says he's the Boston Strangler. And he comes out of the living room where it's all dark and everything. He comes out of the living room and he starts to chase myself and another one of my good friends. And he's just like unbelievable. And he's chasing us through the house. We run into a bathroom, slam the door, and he starts slamming the door with his shoulder. And we're seeing it coming in like this, and we're trying to hold the thing shut. Next thing we know, his whole arm comes through the door. He plows his whole arm through the door, and he's trying to get a hold of us. Finally, he realizes he can't get us. He pulls his arm out and rips his arm all up because the plywood is on the door is going that way. Runs out, chases this girl outside, and on the front row, on the front lawn of their house, he starts to strangle her. And the neighbors are hearing all this screaming, and everybody's out there trying to pull him off, and they can't pull him off, and this girl forgot the name to get him out of this thing. And I thought, you know what? I've got to get out of here. I can't even hang out with my friends anymore. I was just graduating from 10th grade, and the logical thing is to go to a Canadian university college academy, which is an hour and a half away from our home. I decided to go 8 hours the other direction because I realized there's something wrong with this. This is not just mind over matter. There's something inhabiting these people, and I hate to say it today, but most of my friends that were all involved in that, they've long since given up on God. There's no interest whatsoever. And that led into deeper things and finally seances. And I don't even want to get into some of the stuff that took place in their seances. I wasn't there, but they told me the stories. Freaked them out so bad, some of this stuff, they would take their Bible and sleep with it under their pillow for the next month, just trying to get to sleep at night. I'm not saying this to shock anybody. I'm just saying that's the reality of what the devil's up to. But you know what? He so effectively enshrouds himself that you don't even hardly see he's there. And then he has effective ways to use medicine in many cases to hide the real issue. Oh, we'll just diagnose you with this problem, with that problem. I was speaking at a evangelistic school this last summer. Well, summer for you, I guess, June it was. And so I was speaking at this evangelistic thing, and there's a woman there, and she had her three kids there, young kids, like 5 years old and younger. And maybe the one was six, five or six. Anyways, and the kids were coming in and coming out, and I'm thinking, boy, that's pretty brave of this woman to be going to an evangelistic school and have her kids along with her because her husband's out of town working in the oil fields. And so afterwards, somebody said, you know, you ought to hear her story about her son. And I said, okay. So I went up and asked her. I said, tell me about your son. Well, her son had allergies to proteins. Never heard of that before, but he couldn't eat anything protein. And it was just about killing him. And he was losing weight, and they're trying to figure out how do we feed our kid without any protein anywhere. So she's getting desperate, and this mom's telling me this whole thing. I got the whole document in my Bible case. She wrote me out the whole thing. Anyways, so she takes her three-year-old kid, at that point, 3 years old, to all these different doctors, and nobody can do anything. So finally one doctor suggests she go to this naturopathic-type person an hour and a half drive away from their home. So she goes there, and it's this woman. She walks into the house, and this is an Adventist lady, not the one that she's going to, but the one that has the kids. And she goes, and everything in the house is white. She's wearing white, everything. There's nothing in there that isn't white. Piano's white, furniture's white, pictures are white, walls are white. She said there wasn't a thing in there that wasn't white, and the woman is wearing white. So she goes in, she takes her son, and her husband's sitting out in the car waiting. And she says, okay, a few rules here. She takes her into a room. She said, if you want to be in here with your kid, you're not allowed to say a word. You're not allowed to ask me any questions. And she went along with this. And the woman, first thing she does, her kid's sitting there, three-year-old, she goes, whew. Kid falls asleep right on the spot. And for 2 hours, she's got the kid. She'll flip him upside, and he never doesn't wake up. Turn him all different positions. And then she would sit there and hum and put her hands over, not even touching the kid. And going through all this stuff. And now the mother's saying, like, this is weird. She's not even touching the kid, except she'd grab him and just flip him over and then just go with her hands all over the thing. And she's saying, this is weird. So finally the mom, she's breaking the rules now, but she says, can I ask you a question? Is this Wiccan or witchcraft or something? And she says, you're not allowed to ask me any questions. She says, no, I'm just interested. Anyways, make a long story short. From that point on, that kid became such a behavioral problem that he would point at his mom and says, die. And he would do all this stuff and nobody could handle this kid. They sent him to kindergarten a while later. And they kicked him out the first day, sent him another kindergarten school. They kicked him out, and this went on for 2 whole years to the point where he would be. They went to a church retreat at this camp, and 30 feet up, like 10 meters up, is this railing on this catwalk, and the kid is walking down the railing. If he falls this way, he's dead. And everybody said, "Oh, so and so is walking down here." They go to a few minutes later after they get him down there. Somebody come back in. He's tearing a cat to pieces. And this is just like this last June, the mom's telling me all this stuff. So this last January, she doesn't know what to do. Nobody can handle this kid. Everybody in the church doesn't have a clue. And some guy, he's a doctor, he says, you know what? He says, I have never seen anything like this in terms of behavior, but not like this, but he says, I grew up in Jamaica. And he says, I think your son is possessed. He says, you've done anything to allow this to happen? And she says, no, not that I can think of. And he's trying to pry her mind. He says, oh, yeah, well, there was that woman. He explains the whole deal. Anyways, make a long story short, they get a bunch of people together, pastors and stuff, and they pray and they cast out the demons in this young kid, and he is freed. And the very first thing, and he hated his mom. He says, I want you to die. And he'd die, and he'd go, pfft. And this is the way he's living all the time. And he'd bite, and he'd kick, and he'd scream. This is going on and on and on. They're all diagnosing him as autistic. I'm not saying all kids that are autistic, but I mean, that's what they're diagnosing him as. They have this session. First thing he says, I love you, mommy, and I love Jesus. Because before that, he says, I hate Jesus, and I love Satan. When they arrange to have this meeting, that's what the kid says. And there is that kid there that day, loving, reading scripture, praying. And I want to tell you something. You know, sometimes we think, oh, that stuff doesn't exist anymore. It exists everywhere, even in my own life. I get asked all the time to deal with demonic possession. You know what? It's something I don't want to do, something I don't enjoy, but I'm not afraid of it either. Because you know what? I have the power of Jesus. There is power in the name and there's power in the blood, and those are the only two weapons I have when I'm asked to go deal with spiritual warfare. I remember the first time I was involved in this. I'm a layman. I have no training. But here's what happened to me first. I started having nightmares at night. I haven't had nightmares since I was a kid. And all of a sudden, I started having these nightmares at night. Oh, yeah, I'm already involved in ministry and all this kind of stuff. And my nightmares were such nightmares that I'd be squirming, and I'm just in bed. I'm squirming, and I'm whining, and my wife would say, shake me, and what's up? And I said, oh, man, I had this. And I could remember all the details. I dream all the time. I don't remember any of it. I remember every detail of this thing. And in my dream, I'd be up against a demonic possessed person. Where would this come from? I'm thinking, is this Satan doing this to me? God, are you allowing this? What's going on? And I'd be freaked out of my dream so bad that I wouldn't even want to go back to sleep. And then a couple weeks later, another nightmare, same topic. And I'm just squirming. I'm just freaked out, and I can't get away, and I can't do anything. But this kept going on for like 6 months. And I'm just getting like I'm now I'm praying, God, I take this stuff away from me. But you know what started to happen in my dreams? This is really weird. I began to get bolder and bolder with this stuff, and I began using the name of Jesus and the power and the blood that he spilled on Calvary in my dreams. And it began to work in my dreams. Now I'm thinking, why am I going through this stuff? This is just freaking me right out. And then all of a sudden, I'm in a South Pacific place, one of the countries here in the South Pacific. And I finish a series, a big camp. It's the last night we have an altar call. This woman comes up, and she's crying her eyes out, just sobbing. And her friend's got her arm around, and she comes up and sits at the right, up in the front. Meanwhile, I'm talking to this Catholic family to come to every meeting. And I'm having a really good conversation with them. And the conference president comes over, and he says, you need to come right now. And I said, well, no, I'm talking to this couple here. And he says, no, I mean right now. And I thought, well, this is rude. And I says, no, I'll come over in a minute, okay? I'm just talking to this couple. And he says, you need to come right now. He grabs my arm, hauls me over to the front here. And he says, pray for her. Pray about what? I don't know. Is she sick? I don't know what the problem is. So I walk over, and she's just sobbing, and her friend's got her arm around her, and so I start praying for her. And this much I know, because I've seen this a lot. When you give your heart to Jesus, the devil's not going to be happy about that, and he's going to do everything he can to mess you up. And so I rebuked the devil on behalf of her, not knowing what the problem is. But when I did that, all of a sudden, all hell broke loose. And she starts basically screaming, and she had go up, and then she'd go slam down, up and down, and she'd try to jump up, and I'd slam her. I've got no power. I don't know anything. But you know what? I wasn't a bit afraid, because I've already been through all this in my nightmares. It's like, then I begin to understand where those nightmares come from. It was a preparation. I don't know where they actually came from, but it was a preparation. And so all I had was, in the name of Jesus and by the power and the blood that he spilled on Calvary, I command you to leave right now. And this went on for 20 minutes, but 15 minutes into this or so, I said, say the name of Jesus. And she would struggle, and she'd just be trying, and she'd say, God. She couldn't say Jesus. A few minutes later, I'd say the name of Jesus. Do you want to be freed? Yeah, finally say, yeah. And I said, say the name of Jesus. She tries and struggles and only say God. About 20 minutes into this thing, she finally was able to say Jesus, and she collapsed. And then she gets up and she says, what happened? I've never experienced pain like that. And she's going on about this whole ordeal that she's been through. And then all of a sudden she got really bristly. And she said, I'm going to go. And I said, okay, here's the deal. And I talked to a friend. I said, do you mind spending the night praying with her? If you need me, I'll be happy to do that as well. And she says, no, I want to go visit so-and-so. I don't know who this person was, but the people around there knew who this other woman was, and it was part of her problem. So she says, no, you can't go there. And she says, you can't tell me what to do. And so I'm getting that she shouldn't be going there. I says, no, listen here. You need to spend your night here on the camp and have your friend and whoever else you want praying with you. And she turns to me and looks me right in the face, and she says, you can't tell me what to do. And I thought, oh, no. And all of a sudden, she starts screaming again, and she runs behind the stage. So I run back there, start the whole session over, and only lasts 2 minutes. But she was freed. The next day, she was just beaming. Her whole life changed. And I thought, wow, I didn't know this stuff existed hardly anymore. You know, you never talk about it. You never see it. And then after that, it's just more and more and more. I mean, a lot of times I'm preaching. It happened here when I was in 2006. I was in a meeting. Somebody calls me out, and they said they're possessed. Whatever, you have to deal with it. And I'm not saying this to shock anyone. I'm just telling you, Satan is real. He is doing everything he can to destroy you. Because it says in Isaiah 14:20, what does the Satan want to do? He destroys his own land and kills his own people. John 10:10, the devil or the thief comes to do what? Destroy, to steal, and to kill. But I come to give eternal life. So the devil is not happy until he tries to destroy us. But you know, he's subtle. He's like the lion. He comes up, and I'm not talking about possession here in everybody's case. I'm just talking about he's constantly after each one of us. And I remember one time I was preaching in this one place. And the pastor of the church had asked if I would do anointing. He's dying of cancer. He mustered all the strength he could get to come to church. And he said, could you do an anointing for me after church with my whole congregation? I said, I'd be happy to. So I did the service, and I came up after. And then another woman phones up, and she says, her 13-year-old son has got diabetes so bad that they don't even know if he'll live. Can I do an anointing for him too? I mean, I'm nobody. I'm just a layperson. And so So we're getting ready to do this. Everybody's come up the front. And then this guy comes up to me and he says, I heard you pray. I've got demons and I want to be freed. And this guy's like 40 years old and his mom is there and his sister is there. And I said, okay. And I hardly have any time. So I said, okay, let's go in the back here and let's deal with this. I start praying with him. Every time I said the name of Jesus, he would just go, no! And you know, because the devil doesn't want to leave. And you know what? I had no time to finish, and I still feel bad. I found the guy's name after checking with everybody and phoned him up, and I says, look, I'll come out to Alberta where you're from. I'll come out, and we'll finish this. He says, no, I'm fine. And I talked to his sister. No, he's not fine. He was diagnosed with schizophrenia, but really what was going on is he's possessed. But here's the good news. The good news, there is power in the name of Jesus. There is power in the blood that he spilled on Calvary. And that is what I want to ally with every day of my life. I don't enjoy doing these things. Have to do them all the time. But you know what? The devil has no strength whatsoever in the front of, in under the name of Jesus and under the power and the blood he spilled on Calvary. Because you know what Jesus did on Calvary? He defeated Satan once and for all. But here's the worry we have to have. It's not so much about possession and those things. It's the way he sneaks up. It's how subtle he is. You know what Satan's favorite deception is? Putting discontentment in your heart. How does he do that? Every advertisement you watch or you hear or you see in a newspaper has one thing in common, because I've studied advertising. Advertising's primary objective is to do this: create discontentment in you so you're not satisfied with what you have. You have to buy their product. That is just one small way. But then Satan gives us movies, and he gives us all these different things. And what does he do in there? He sets the plot up to do what? To make you discontent with what you have, discontent with your own life. And once he begin to focus inwardly rather than upwardly, now he's got on a path. He's got you on a path where ultimately he wants to destroy you. But you know what? If you constantly look upwards, he's never going to get to you. If you constantly give yourself to Jesus every day, he has nothing over you. I get oppressed all the time by the devil. And I will share it one of these nights. Probably a lot of you heard about the fact that I was arrested and thrown in federal prison in the United States for 5 days. They filed 6 ridiculous felony charges against me and tried to put me in jail for 27 years, the United States government. My indictment said Herb Larsen versus the United States of America. U.S. was against Afghanistan. U.S. was against Iraq. Now they're against Herb. Quite intimidating. But the second I was arrested and thrown in jail at the border, I knew right now the devil is trying to shut me down. And how would I expect not to be hammered if it weren't for the fact that the devil doesn't want me to do what I do? I will share the rest of that. You know, I'll share that story one of these nights here. Bottom line is this: I'm here. So someone's victorious. I serve a God that has way more power than the devil. I serve a God that covers me with the blood of his son. I choose to be covered with the blood of Jesus every day. I choose to spend a serious amount of time with Jesus every day, because it has changed my life. It gives me a rich life. And you know what? Not that I enjoy going up against the devil, but I have absolutely no problem putting my life in Jesus and saying, get lost in the name of Jesus. There's many times I'm sitting at my desk and all of a sudden I just feel anger or something happening. I know right now what it is. It's just the old devil trying to get me down. I rebuke him audibly on the spot and it's gone. There's power in the blood of Jesus. Because when he was on that cross, he paid the price for me. He paid the price for you. He paid the price for the person who has somehow let Satan inhabit them and become possessed. He paid that price so they can be free. And you know, there's nothing to worry about any of this stuff, but the point is this: yes, there is something to worry about. What there is to worry about is the fact that the devil is alive and well in these last days. And the real problem to worry about is the fact that he's so cunning you don't see him coming up on you. And the only way around that worry is to completely dedicate yourself to Jesus and spend a serious amount of time with him. When the Bible says pray without ceasing, what does it mean? Does it mean fold your hands, close your eyes? No, you know what it means? It has a prayerful heart, constantly think of Jesus. I love spending my days with Jesus. I finished a big plant recently in Alberta. Now, a lot of you guys don't know, but Alberta is the next province over from us, and it's a cold place. And somehow we got stuck putting the last part of this plant that I built and designed, the outside of the plant in the middle of the winter over there, and they had their worst winter in the last 50 years. So we were putting this plant together in minus 30 and minus 40 degree weather. Well, I'm telling you something, that is shocking. And so, but here's the thing. So we got a crane, $600 an hour, a crane lifting this great big piece of machinery in, and it's all its bolt holes has to fit that we put into the concrete. And so I'm like, oh no, man, if this doesn't work, we're stuck out here freezing to death. Plus it's costing me $600 an hour for this crane. And I'm praying about this, and my employees, they aren't even Adventists, but I mean, they're not even Christians, some of them. I mean, one of them's an atheist. And I'm always saying, thank you, Jesus. I just pray that this thing goes well. And they're just like, oh, man, this guy's whacked out. You know, all of a sudden the crane goes like this, and I'm watching him thinking, oh, man, please, Jesus, you know. And all of a sudden, boom, all the bolts go through the holes. And it's like, you know what I do? I say, thank you, Jesus, that was awesome. You couldn't roll the dice and make that happen again. How we got those bolts perfectly in the concrete when everything's moving and all that. I tell you, I love working with Jesus. Because anytime those good little things happen, I glorify him in front of my employees. I just went back to the plant and all their employees at this plant. So I was back at the plant last week. I had to go for 3 days to do a few tune-ups on the programming and stuff. And so while I'm there, we're working on something. I don't even remember what it was right now. But one of their employees, it all just happened. It just worked perfect. And he says, thank you, Jesus, right? And I says, yeah, I'm sorry I didn't bring it up first. You know? Oh, I know what it was. We had to put these pieces of metal way up into this tight place and whatever, and we didn't think we'd get in there and it all fit. And so anyways, the bottom line, the reason why I wanted to bring this stuff up tonight is like I said, not to shock people or anything else, but the bottom line is the devil is out to get you. He's out to get me. There is only one defense, and that is ally completely with Jesus. And how do you ally with Jesus? You spend a serious amount of time with him every day in the Bible and on your knees. And I thank Jesus daily for the peace of mind I have. I thank him daily for the blessings he gives me. Yes, the devil's there always throwing sand in my face. You can't expect to do ministry and not have the devil hitting you from every angle that he can. But you know what? God gives you the power to overcome the oppression. Not possession, but oppression, the harassment. Like when I was ready, you know, like when I was ready to go to jail possibly for 27 years. Yes, I had my low days, but there wasn't one time in the 2.5 years that led up to that trial that I didn't realize clearly this was an assault from the devil. And I even told my wife, if God wants me to go to jail, I'll go to jail. But I don't think that's God's plan, but I will. And to see God's hand come through the very end and just release me, awesome. He's a God I want to serve. And before we leave this place tonight, we're going to be spending a lot of time talking about God behind the scenes this week. And I just want each one of us to prepare our hearts, let the Holy Spirit work, and to work inside out. Like that's what our topic was in 2006. To work inside out, to mold and to shape us and turn us into the instruments he wants, which guess what? Each one of us will be there to step on the toes of the devil whenever he tries to do anything to us or anybody else. Because the thing is Paul, you know, we've all had problems, right? How many here haven't had problems in life? Okay, no hands. I expected that. But the devil's always throwing problems at our way. And Paul somehow said this. He said, I take joy in adversity. Now, how could he say that? It's because Paul looked at it this way. When the devil was at him, beatings, jail, everything he went through. When the devil was at him, you know that game, hot or colder? Have you played that here when you're kids? You know, you hide something for the kids, and then you say, okay, they come into the room. They go this direction, colder, 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 warmer, 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 hotter, hotter, hotter. Well, you're telling them which direction. Paul knew that when the devil was at him, he was stepping on the toes of Satan. He knew that whenever I'm being oppressed, I know exactly what's going on. This is the direction I want to continue to go in. Thanks for informing me, Satan. That's the way Paul thought about it. And that's the way we should be thinking about it. When adversity comes, you know, I tell lots of people, they say, oh man, I've just been, this has happened, that's happened. I says, you know what I'm thinking about? God's got a great plan for you, and the devil doesn't want it to happen. So get with the plan. Because when you get with the plan, yeah, the problems will still be there, but you can overcome those. And I've been through a lot of tough stuff in my life, and continue to go through tough stuff in my life. But the thing is, God gives you that strength during those low times. If you constantly focus on Him and recognize He is your master, He is your friend, He is your Abba Father, and Jesus is your brother. And you know, God is so much more incredible to me when I see what the devil tries to do me and what God offers me, that it totally draws me to Him every day. And I just pray that each one of us here tonight, if you're going through any adversity or any tough times right now, or you have family members that are going to tough times, recognize this. God has nothing to do with it. But the direction you want to go is to Jesus. And focus completely on Him, giving yourself completely over to Him every day. And I'll guarantee this much. He will give you strength to overcome that adversity you're going through, whether it's financial, whether it's relationship breakups, whatever it is. Those are things the devil's brings on us. But God is there to overcome those because Jesus has already defeated Him on the cross, and He gives us His strength and His victory. And as my friend Andy, is he here? Yeah, so Andy, if you want to come up, he's going to share a song here. Give them all to Jesus. That's right. Yeah, all your problems. There we go. I knew it was thematic. The song, Give Them All to Jesus. And here's the first line. I went and talked to him before. Are you tired of chasing pretty rainbows? Give everything to Jesus. Thanks for sharing, my good friend who deceived me.
You going to sing with me, Herb?
Yeah, I should.
Are you tired of chasing pretty rainbows? Are you tired of spinning round and round? Wrap up all the shattered dreams of your life, and at the feet of Jesus, lay them down. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams and wounded hearts and broken toys. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrow into joy. He never said you'd only see sunshine, and He never said there'd be no rain. He only promised a heart full of singing about the very things that once brought pain. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams and wounded hearts and broken toys. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy. I know you know this song. Sing it with me. Give them all, give them all, give them all to Jesus. Shattered dreams and wounded hearts and broken toys. Give them all, give them all. Give them all to Jesus, and He will turn your sorrows into joy.
Father God, to follow up on that song right now, not only do we want to give all our problems and all our issues to you, but we want to give ourselves to you as gratitude and thanks for what you've done for each one of us. As we go from this place right now, Father, we just pray that you'd give us angels that excel in strength to defend each one of us. We're praying down the power and the presence of the Holy Spirit to touch each one of us for the remainder of this week here together and this weekend. In the name of Jesus, thank you. Amen.
So much, Herb. Thank you so much, Andy. I hope you this message can touch your hearts, and as you go slowly home, please pick up your kids from the crèche.